A very good evening, everyone present here and connected virtually. Our distinguished speaker of the evening, Honorable Minister of State for Education and External Affairs, Dr. Rajkumar Ranjan Singh, sir, has joined and is connected with us. Warm welcome to you, sir. Namaskar, sir. Before we begin, I would request everyone present here to keep your mobile phone on silent mode. And those who are connected virtually, kindly keep your audio device on mute mode. However, during the question answer session, you may ask questions through the messaging facility provided in the meeting platform through chat messages. It is our privilege and honor that on the third anniversary of Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center for Leadership, Policy and Governance, we have amongst us Dr. Rajkumar Ranjan Singh, Honorable Minister of State for Education and External Affairs, Government of India, as the distinguished speaker for the function. On behalf of IIM Ranchi, I once again extend a very warm welcome to our Honorable Distinguished Speaker. I request faculty members, students, and staff members of IIM Ranchi to kindly join me in welcoming the Director IIM Ranchi, Professor Shailendra Singh, sir, present here. The guests present physically and virtually, and the correspondents from media who are connected virtually. Now, I take this opportunity to introduce the passionate team of our faculty members who are involved with the Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center for Leadership, Policy and Governance. Professor Aditya Shankar Mishra from marketing area. Professor Gaurav Manohar Marathe from the OBHR area. They both are the co-chairpersons of the Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center. Professor Anshuman Hazarika, sir, from General Management Area, Ethics and Business Law, and Professor Sakshi from the area of Economics are the members of the Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center for Leadership, Policy and Governance. Shri Atal Bihari Vajpayee ji said, thank you, sir. Thank you, madam. Now, we shall seek blessing from Ma Saraswati. I request the audience to please rise for the same. I request you all to remain standing. Join us for Rashtriya.
Vande Mataram, Sujalam, Sufalam.
Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seat. Now, I request Professor Aditya Shankar Mishra, sir, Chairperson Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center, to give the introduction of the honorable distinguished speakers and topic of today's webinar.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. We at Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center for Leadership, Policy and are privileged to have you here for we understand reforms for good governance, we must understand what governance is. Good governance as a as old as our human civilization. It is the process of effective decision making and the process by which decisions are implemented. Governance can be used in several contexts, such as corporate governance, international governance, national governance, and local governance. Right from the pages of ancient scriptures to the thoughts of leaders, thinkers of the times, we learn various conceptions of good governance. We get a glimpse of its meaning in the concept of Ram Rajya, the term popularized by father of the nation Gandhiji. Sage Valmiki explains the meaning of Ram Rajya in Yuddha Kand of Ramayana. He says, "Na parya devanna vidava, na cha vyal kritam bhayam, na vyadhijam bhayan vapi, rame rajyam prashasati. Sarvam mudit meva sit sarvo, dharm paro bhavat, ram mevanu pashyanto, nabhya hinsan parasparam. Sarve sampanna, sarve dharm parayana." It means, while Rama was ruling the kingdom, there were no widows to lament, no danger from wild animals, nor any fear of diseases. Every creature felt pleased. Everyone was engaged in turning their towards Rama alone. Creatures did not kill one another. All the people were endowed with excellent characteristics. All were engaged in dharma. One sloka in Upanishad 2 explains the virtues of good governance. It says, "Sarve bhavantu sukhina, sarve santira, sarve bhadrani pashyantu, ma kaschid dukha." Similar message is also given in Gita about the way government should be run. It says, quote, "One should understand what duty is and what not duty is by the regulation," quote. Good governance also reflected in the thinking of Mahatma Gandhi when he suggested the administrators to always keep the last man of the society in mind while framing welfare policies. In present times, the idea of good governance is prevalent in the thinking of Honorable Prime Minister Modi ji when he gave the slogan of Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, Sabka Vishwas, Sabka Prayas. On this note, I, Professor Aditya Shankar Mishra, welcome you to the third anniversary lecture being conducted by Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center for Leadership, Policy and Governance, a center of excellence under IIM Ranchi. The center ABV-CLPG was established in 2018 to conduct multidisciplinary research and to work as a think tank to assist the government and non-government organizations in the issues related to leadership, policy, and governance. Our center is trying to disseminate the knowledge which is based on the research output and experience gained by the senior administrators and innovators. In line with this objective, anniversary lectures have been a great source of knowledge sharing. We feel privileged to have hosted Honorable Minister in Government of India, General V.K. Singh, for the first lecture and Honorable Vice President of India, Sri Venkaiya Naidu Ji, for the second lecture. It is an honor to introduce the distinguished speaker for the third anniversary lecture, Honorable Minister of State for Education and External Affairs, Government of India, Dr. R. Ranjan Singh Ji. Dr. Singh was sworn in as Union Minister of State on 7th July 2021. He is a postgraduate in geography and earned his PhD from Guwahati University. He served in different capacities, including as a lecturer, assistant professor, deputy registrar. He also served as director in charge of UGC Academic Staff College and College Development Director of Manipur University till his supervision in 2012. He was a senior visiting fellow in the Department of Geography in Manipur University until he joined electoral politics in 2013. He has published 8 books and made numerous contributions to various national and international journals and publications. During his academic career, Dr. Singh also participated in several national and international consultative meetings on human resource management, security, and land and livelihood rights of indigenous people. Since his election as a member of the 17th Lok Sabha in 2019, Dr. Singh has actively participated as a member to the parliamentary committees on Central Council of Health and Family Welfare, Standing Committee for Science and Technology, Environment and Forest and Climate Change, Consultative Committee for DONER, and Parliamentary Rules Committee. On the behalf of ABCLPG and IIM Ranchi, I thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation and welcome you to the event. It is my privilege introduce our Honorable Chairman, Mr. Praveen Sankar Pandya Ji. Mr. Pandya is the Director of the Sankar Group of Industries. He was also the Chairman of Diamond India Limited, a company formed by 60 leading industrialists from the diamond industry. Mr. Pandya has played an active and leading role in industry bodies and social activities. He was Chairman of the Gem and Jewelry Export Promotion Council, the apex body set up by the Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India from 96 to 2000, and is a director of the Indian Institute of Gems and Jewelry set up by the council. He was also a member of the National Board of Trade set up by the Ministry of Commerce and Industry from 97 to 2002. I welcome you, sir, to the event. Next, I would like to introduce the Honorable Director of IIM Ranchi, Professor Shailendra Singh Ji. Since 2017, when he joined, under his able leadership, IIM Ranchi has been achieving greater heights on various academic performance indicators. Prior to the present assignment, Professor Singh was the Dean Research and a Senior Professor in the area of Human Resource Management at Indian Institute of Management, Lucknow. He has also served as the President and has been elected as a Fellow of National Academy of Psychology, India. He has more than 34 years of post-PhD research and teaching experience. He has a vast and varied experience in training, administration, and consultancy. Last but not the least, I would like to welcome the audience and would request them to listen to the distinguished speaker and enhance their information. Now, Honorable Director, sir, take over and say a few words about the Institute and Center. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Aditya Mishra ji, for introducing the theme and the honorable speaker. I have the responsibility to introduce the institute and the center. Sir, with your permission, I would like to inform that Indian Institute of Management Ranchi, the 9th Institute of Management in the series, was born on 15th December 2009. A great lineage that we inherited. And the first IIM, that is IIM Calcutta, we got mentored by that. We are young, 12-year institution, but going strength to strength, our faculty numbering 53, drawn from all over the world, is making its mark in academics and research domain. Last year, we have published more than 50 research papers in various journals of repute, and you were involved in declaring an IRF ranking. This year we have improved our research score. Our ranking was 21. Students are the strength of any institution. Alumni are the strength of any institution. Let me just say, in past 12 years, we have done 9 convocations and more than 1,000 strong alumni are making impact all over the world in the domain of management. This year, that will be our 10th convocation, and we are having close to 300 graduates waiting for their convocation. They have already joined various organizations. Our strength is from not only students and faculty, our staff members are equally dedicated to make the life of faculty and student comfortable. Their contribution is always recognized with the positive feedback and applaud from all the students and stakeholders. Honorable Chairman, Board of Governors, Sri Ravin Sankarji Pandya, has been the leading light for giving us a great lead. And we were little laggard in terms of our campus, and Honorable Minister, I will request you from this forum that please help us getting our grant release so that we can complete our campus on time. We are still waiting for that. Sir, in 2018, when Atal Bihari Vajpayee moved for heavenly abode, we thought that this will be the real tribute to open a center in his name. And the Center for Leadership, Policy and Governance was born. And as Aditya ji has already told, that we have already commemorated 2 anniversary lectures. This lecture was due during the month of February, March, and because of the COVID and other issues, it was postponed. And I met you, sir, in the month of July and requested that time, please grace the occasion for this lecture. And you have been the great source of inspiration and strength for us by accepting our invitation. So we are doing good job at Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center. We have already conducted many studies, seminars, webinars, to name a few. Jharkhand state observed school mergers. What is the impact of the school merger? We have done the study, and it has already been submitted to the government of Jharkhand. We have done winter schools and summer schools for many budding public administration scholars. Very soon, we are going to launch Mahatma Gandhi National Fellowship Program at our institute, and on 25th October, the same will be inaugurated by Honorable Minister of Education and Skill Development, Sri Dharmendra Pradhan ji. So we have been involved in multiple ways to help the state government and central government in developing policy and governance issues and managing those, and hope that institute is going to come long way by conducting its studies, its researches, and emerge as a think tank in the area of leadership, policy, and governance. With these few words, I again request you, sir, and thank you for accepting our invitation.
Thank you, sir. Now, I request Honorable Distinguished Speaker, sir, to kindly address the audience.
Professor Shailendra Singh Ji, Director, IIT, Indian Institute of Management, Ranchi, and Professor Aditya Shankar Mishra Ji, and also a visionary person like Mr. Pandya Ji and Hazarika Ji, thank you very much for inviting me on this solemn occasions. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for that kind of introduction. It is a privilege to speak at this third annual lecture of Atul Bihari Vajpayee Center for Leadership, Policy, and Governance, where I have been informed that the inaugural lecture was given by retired General B.P. Singh Ji, and the last annual lecture was given by Honorable Vice President of India, Mr. Venkaiah Naidu Ji. I would like to thank IIM Ranchi and its Center of Excellence, Atul Bihari Vajpayee Ji Center for Leadership, Policy, and Governance Department for organizing the annual event again and inviting me for the lecture this year. It gives me great pleasure and pride to be associated with such prestigious institute. Ek Bharat, Swasthya Bharat, and the word like reform, perform, and transform provide insights about the concept of good governance. We affirm our commitment to providing the people for this country with transparent, effective, and accountable governance. Let us join together to carry out this objective of good governance. The effort to usher in an era of Sushasan has just begun and begun on a very promising note. We vote to create an open and responsible administration, and we intended to do so. In my remark today, I'm going to discuss some of these positive developments in promoting good governance, which is relevant for India. Today, I would like to use this as well as my own experience to highlight some of the ways in which the goal of good governance might be implemented. Under the vision of Honorable Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi ji, a series of reforms, both big and small, undertaken by his government has led India to improve its ranking in the World Bank's ease of doing business ranking and be included among the most favored nation for foreign direct investment, in turn leaving behind many larger economies of the world in economic growth. The simplification of the government procedures and processes in order to make the entire system visible and speedier is a significant step towards good governance. Whether it is about getting a new passport or a railway ticket or a tax refund or registering any new company or a business, these processes ought to be made simple. The Indian government, under the leadership of Prime Minister Sri Modi ji, has simplified these processes, which has also reduced the rent seeking and or favor seeking opportunities by bringing greater transparency. Good governance means an accountable government, and we look forward to continuously fulfilling that goal. The move away from affidavits and attestation in favor of self-certification is another sign of the citizens-friendly policies of the current government. Another major area is the elimination of burdensome and outdated legislation that are no longer relevant. The repeal acts have already been brought for special repeal of such outdated legislation, and more are being considered. To further the principle of a friendly government, redressal of public grievances is a crucial component of our government's responsive administration. I have directed all of the senior officers to make sure that resolving public issues is given top priority. We can also learn about the instances of good governance from the Bhagavad Gita, which gives several clues for effective governance, leadership, sustainability, and self-realization, all of which are reinterpreted in a modern context. In India, the concept of good governance was historically talked about in the well-being of people, and it was deemed vital in the position of king in Kautilya's Arthashastra. The treatise says that in the happiness of his subject lies his happiness, in their welfare, his welfare. On the qualities of good monarch, Kautilya says about an ideal king, what pleases himself, he does not consider an excellent, but what pleases his flock are considered as good. Our father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi, also emphasized Suraj, which essentially mean good governance. There are 8 major qualities of good governance. It is democratic, consensus-driven, accountable, transparent, responsive, effective and efficient, as well as equitable and inclusive, and it adheres to the rule of law. It ensures that corruption is minimized, minorities' perspectives are considered, and the voice of society's most vulnerable are heard. in decision making. It is also relevant to society's current and future requirement. I can tell you from personal experience that putting that vision into action is a huge challenge. Reforms, both in terms of policy and implementation, do not happen quickly. Pure technological solutions are rarely successful, no matter how correct they are. It is necessary to understand and handle vested interests, history, competing demand, and surging expectations. A country can only move as quick as its policies will allow. Right to information and e-governance are two key efforts that have recently been launched in India in order to empower the ordinary man and ensure good governance. Citizenship and the right to information are the heart of democratic administration. Every person has the right to take part in civic life, governance, and society. On October 12, 2005, the Right to Information Act was enacted, signaling a dramatic shift in Indian democracy and ushering in a new era of common man's empowerment in India. The right to information is drawn from the fundamental right to freedom of expression. As a signatory to the International Convention on Civil and Political Rights, India owes it to its citizens to adequately protect their right to information under Article 19 of the ICCPR. Good governance means an acceptable government, an efficient administration. Good governance is all about promoting growth and development, about providing a conducive economic environment for the industry to thrive. It is not enough to be clean or to be non-corrupt. The administration needs to be sensitive to the issues that the citizens encounter in their interface with the government and address those efficiently. The principle of good governance has been implemented by the current government under the leadership of visionary Prime Minister Shri Modi ji through a few prominent initiatives which I would like to highlight here. E-governance efficiently provide improved programs and services in the era of fast expanding information and communication technology, which serve the new potential for rapid social and economic revolution around the world. Government at both the national and state levels are working to realize their full potential and to use in a new era of economic and social growth. E-governance has a direct impact on its citizens who derive benefit through direct transaction with the services offered by the government. It explores a new pack of leadership approach, skill, and mindset of the citizens of the country. However, the process of e-governance requires sustained commitment, political will, adequate resources, which can develop a system of e-governance in order to make the current policies and practices of the government more efficient and effective. E-governance can renovate the relationship between the public-private sector. The government and enable better policy outcome, high quality services, the greater engagement with the citizens of the country. The motto and the guiding philosophy of the current government is citizens first. Our ambition has always been to bring the government closer to our citizens so that they may participate actively in the governance process. Our government has been working diligently towards this aim for the past 7 years. The initiative of the government to use MyGovIn and interaction with the Honorable Prime Minister aim to make this involvement more relevant. The tremendous response that these initiatives have elicited places a heavy burden on our soldier. And we pledge that we will not fail you. We are also advocating for the re-engineering of government processes. Ministries and the Department of the Indian government have been directed by our Prime Minister to examine their job areas and internal processes in order to determine what and how they might be simplified and rationalized. I am confident that technology can and must help to bridge the gap between the government and citizens. Technology is both an empowering tool for citizens and a means of governance accountability. Our government understands the innermost potential of this tool. Though the Digital India movement, we want to convert India into digitally empowered society and knowledge economy. It is a transformational initiative that is being implemented in phases to ensure that residents have access to government services over the internet. It would also increase accountability by requiring government services to be delivered electronically. To achieve good governance, the government is on a mission to pursue the principle and vision of good governance with clarity, conviction, compassion, and consistency in governing. Transparency, participation, and effective governance are all enhanced by clarity. Conviction encourages transparent and effective governance. Compassion encourages people to work together to achieve a common goal, equitable as well as democratic governance. Consistency supports responsive government, upholds the rule of law, and modernizes itself in response to the needs and changes of society while adhering to the constitutional's guiding principles. The government must work as a facilitator for the people, the market, and civil society, while also remaining a prudent regulator to promote social equity and fair competitions. We aim to convey the challenges in the government's role clearly to the public so that they understand why these changes are beneficial to them. Decentralization is a critical component of government efficiency and responsiveness. By devolving administrative and economic power and duties, the government will strengthen local government and administration. People will be directly involved in the management of the services they utilize by the government. The government is committed to reducing citizens' interactions with the government department by introducing internet, web, and e-governance technology to construct national electronic highways and network at all points of contact between the citizen and the government. The government's principles responsibility is to provide efficient and responsive services, making it simple for citizens to obtain important information from the government and ensuring that they have access to producers that punish and misbehavior. To improve the quality and efficiency of public services, we will take all possible steps. The key challenges then is to capture this positive spirit and translate into action to pull together a strategy to achieve government's vision that has clear target and a management structure to keep reform on track. The most fundamental problems or meta problem of problems in the problems of leadership at the grassroots level. I wish all of you to become the leaders who can lead in the right direction, alignment, and commitment to create good governance in whichever field that you go, as India needs good governance. And good governance need good leaders at the grassroots. After all, the country's good governance will only flourish if every Indian citizen ignites the flame of patriotism by sticking to truth, peace, and nonviolence as a method of perceiving the India of our dream. Every attendance should swear at this event that the moral ideals that guide our lives would never be stayed away by money or muscle strength. We must allow our moral strength to triumph over our physical strength. Let us take inspiration from our Indian ancestors as responsible citizens of the country. It is our primary responsibility to continue to vote for honest and upright citizens who can serve as effective administrators and reformers to bring constructive change to our country. Thank you very much. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.
Thank you, sir. We are grateful for your thoughts and experiences you shared with us. It was really informative yet thought-provoking. We are privileged to hear from you, sir. Thank you very much. Now, this is the time for our question and answer round. For this, I invite Professor Anshuman Hazarika, sir, to kindly moderate this session.
Thank you, madam. Respected Minister, sir, Honorable Director of IIM Ranchi, and Honorable Chairman of the Board, it's my privilege to conduct the question and answer for today's event. And we have a few questions that we have compiled from the Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center that we believe can shed more light on the topic today. Sir, we'd like to begin with the first question, which is something which is very relevant for today's society. That is, how has the idea of governance changed in the world which has now multiple sources of information like social media or even people and influencers who continuously feed information which may or may not be true? How has the idea of governance changed in such a scenario?
It's better to have all the questions are putting together, then let us see it.
Yes, sir. Okay. And we have a second question is, how do we inspire our youth to be included in the governance process? How do we get them to be a part of the governance process? And lastly, how can we as people help the government in dealing with the continuously new challenges which emerge in the governance process and in dealing with new challenges which emerge both internally within the country and from external sources? That's from our end. Thank you, sir.
The idea of good governance, particularly when the NDA government took over the charge of governing the country under the leadership of Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi ji. And also, perhaps all of us well aware that the inspiration of good governance is starting from the Atal Bihari Vajpayee ji, and perhaps he, on his birthday, we keep as a good governance day. So like that, the people's, we are, the Indian legacy is that Ram Raja, as you have stated earlier, and also the Kautilya Shastra, they are giving all the concepts of good governance and serving to the peoples. And in the meantime, quite a long after the independence of India, peoples were suffering and peoples are not getting the good governance, what you call the result of the governance to the peoples, to the poor people. And that's why we inspire our team of the governance under the leadership of Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi ji. We are trying to implement as far as practicable the good governance, the direct benefit delivery to the common peoples, and also strengthening the common man. These are some of the concepts we inspire. And of course, we need a lot of technical and innovative ideas we require. And second one, what you have said about the inspiring of? Second one?
About inspiring the youth to take part in the governance process and in the government.
Yeah. See, our Prime Minister's Mann Ki Baat, perhaps all of us well aware of it. And he describes the practice of democracy not is not mean only casting of the vote. He said that the participation by the public is the real democracy. And that's why the good governance should bring only by the new generations with the ideas of patriotism and nationalism. That's why we may inspire our younger generation. On the other hand, India is having a maximum population on the youths. So the youths has the capacity to change the nation and to build the nation with a knowledge-based society, along with that knowledge economy and others that can be bring. That's why we would like to draw the attention and make the awareness to all the youths of the country to participate in the active democracy, actively participate to the democratic the process so that most of the youths will be attracted. And third one is?
So the third question was, how can we the people help in dealing with the challenges which keep on coming in the issue of good governance on both internal and external?
As I have stated in my speech also, the good governance needs the step-by-step to implement. Say, for example, the using of technology and the digital transformation, like that, no, we need those grievances, those difficulties encountered in the process of providing good governance. That has to be rectified, but of course it will take some time. So these are some of the few things which I would like to supplement.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words and for answering the questions. I'd now like to hand it over to Mrs. Kindu to take it. Thank you.
Now it is the time to felicitate the honorable distinguished speaker. I request Director Sir, Professor Shailendra Singh Sir, to kindly present a memento as a token of gratitude to honorable speaker. As the online mode is the new normal, we are presenting the memento online and request honorable speaker sir to kindly accept it virtually.
Thank you, sir,
for accepting our memento and token of gratitude. This shall be sent through courier to your address, sir. Now, I would like to call upon the stage Professor Anshuman Hazarika, sir, for a vote of thanks.
Thank you, madam. Namaste, everyone. It is my privilege to present a vote of thanks at the third annual lecture of the Atal Bihari Vajpayee Center for Leadership, Policy and Governance. At the outset, I would like to thank our honorable guest and speaker for the day, Dr. Rajkumar Ranjan Singh, Minister of State for Education and External Affairs, who enlightened us with his speech and also spared his valuable time to attend the event today at the Institute. I would also like to thank our chairperson, Mr. Pandya, for gracing the occasion. It is also a privilege for us to be led by Honorable Director, Dr. Shailendra Singh, who has led us through in the entire process of organizing the event and also has ensured that all the processes leading to the event are conducted successfully. We would also like to thank our faculty members and staff members who have supported us in conducting the event. It has been their support, consistent support, and their dedication which has taken us here. I take this opportunity to thank the chairpersons of the center, Professor Aditya Mishra and Professor Marathe, and our member of the center, Professor Sakshi, who have consistently helped us and who has taken this center ahead in the last few years. I'd like to thank all the departments of IIM Ranchi and the IT department and the purchase and administrative department who have taken dedicated efforts to take the event forward. At last, I'd like to thank the media persons and everyone who has been present here and all the dignitaries who have supported us in conducting this event. And we look forward to see you all soon in the future as well. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for the national anthem.
Janagana mana adhinayaka jaya he Bharata bhagya vidhata Punjab Sindh Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Vanga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchchala Jaladhi Taranga Tava Shubha Name Jage Tava Shubha Ashish Mage Gahe Tava Jaya Gatha Janagana Mangala Dayaka Jaya He Bharata Bhagya Vidhata Jaya He Jaya He Jaya He Jaya 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 He
Thank you. With this, we conclude our event. I thank one and all for connecting with us virtually and all present over here. Especially, I thank our honorable distinguished guest to spare his valuable time and he has addressed us. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.